Welcome to this episode of Bone Hunt, Discovering Dinosaurs with AI. I'm Bob Chesebrough. I'm a solution engineer and technical evangelist supporting oneAPI AI here at Intel Corporation. To begin your dinosaur hunt, you need to collect data. Our code examples show some well-known places, including Dinosaur National Monument in Jensen, Utah, and the Mill Creek Dinosaur Trail near Moab. These are places where you can go and collect your waypoints, look at bones to study them, study the rock types, or get your aerial photos from those areas. The first thing you will need to do is to record the tracks you make, including the trails and the routes you take, by collecting them on your GPS. This will give you a good idea of where you've been so you don't duplicate your efforts later. If you find something, you can make a waypoint, which forms the basis of your AI data. Your waypoints will be your GPS coordinates, which, correlated with pictures you may have taken of the area and associated timestamps, will help you document where you have been. You'll want to make your waypoints detailed, so include latitude and longitude as precisely as possible. Include altitude and observations about rocks, pebbles, and clasts to help identify your exact location, and reference a geologic map to identify visible deposits. The more you can describe, the better off you will be. After doing that, you need to clean your data to make it consistent. Now, this can be tricky. When you're only finding a few bones at a time, it's not that hard because you'll remember every waypoint. You'll remember the story that goes along with it, and you'll have the pictures. But it becomes a much more intractable problem when you go from a few bones to 100 to a few thousand, because a GPS on any given day or any given hour will not reproduce the exact coordinates. Your GPS coordinates will be different. It's just a sampling of your position, an estimate, typically plus or minus 10 meters of where you are. So if you have hundreds of waypoints or locations, it gets tricky to know whether you have already collected that waypoint, or you'll forget if you've previously found a bone, so you'll collect another waypoint, which is how you end up with duplicates. That is part of your challenge, to be precise when you're describing these things. Even though you can take these GPS coordinates and export them as a CSV file for a spreadsheet, it's difficult to isolate the duplicates. You can use a Haversine formula and a distance formula to estimate the distance between two pairs of points on your GPS. You can begin to cluster them and use clustering software to identify where these fossil locations are. And you can do your best to try to remove the duplicates so that if you share it with a museum, as I have done, the information is pared down. Now, that task is approximate. I'm sure I've not told the museum about bones we found because they looked like duplicates, and I inadvertently remove the information during the cleaning phase. You often won't know what to call the fossil sample. You'll end up describing it as resting on the surface or embedded in sandstone, etc. You make as many annotations as you can. Then you organize them and pre-process the data. Part of the pre-processing step for me is to remove the latitude and longitude information and turn those into pixel coordinates. I do this because I am obligated to try to keep these things obfuscated so people don't steal the bones. I use a mapping function to map from the GPS coordinates to image plane coordinates for an aerial photo, for example. A cool thing about doing this project is that I've demonstrated that by keeping the model simple with ResNet 18 model, we could use the CPU for deep learning and train it using fine-tuning. So even though the model is trained on ImageNet and there aren't aerial photos in the ImageNet dataset, we can use those libraries. Now, we've collected quite a few bone sample locations. One of the things that you have to do is to consider augmenting your dataset, meaning perform different transformations on the images to give your model a new look at the data, rotating the images, for example, zooming in and out slightly. You don't want to zoom very much, maybe up to 5%, because that will change the nature of the photo. Some of the information comes from texture, which is also dictated by the zoom level. You don't want to change the color hues or saturation because some vital information comes from color. With all of that said, rotations, translations, and flips are significant augmentations that are wise to do for these models. One thing I want to recommend, and something that we did with this project, is that we were trying to make the modeling and the labeling as simple as possible. To quote Einstein, make everything as simple as possible, but no simpler. And that's what we were trying to do. We are using a ResNet, but avoiding simpler machine learning models. We're using a simple ResNet convolutional neural network. We benefit from that convolutional nature because it's looking for those patterns, structures, and shapes across each image. And that's a wrap on the training and collection process. You can find links to resources, tools, and downloads, as well as where to go to learn more about everything in this series in the description. Remember to like and share this video and subscribe to the Intel Software YouTube channel. In our next episode, we will give you all a brief overview of the tools we use in this series, the Intel DevCloud, oneAPI, PyTorch, and OpenVINO.
Let the adventure begin.